setting up the laptop, I know that we need a Phaco machine for the removal of the nucleus, because all other steps can be done without the Phaco machine through the small incision. So the incision size was reduced because we could remove the nucleus through a very small incision. So this course is basically managing the nucleus in a different case scenarios. So first is that some of the basics I will like to highlight before we go on to that. And these are the topics we are going to cover: the basics of nucleotomy, soft cataract, posterior polar cataract, heart cataract, wind intumescent cataract, nucleus management in presence of a small pupil, nucleus management in presence of corneal opacity, subluxated cataract, and in presence of PCR. So the some anatomical facts we need to understand while we remove the nucleus. We need to understand something about the machine and a chopper and certain nucleus removal techniques. So basics are the same irrespective of the situation. So parameter settings and how difficult the nucleus is going to be removal, that depends upon the type of the cornea you have got, anterior chamber depth, how is the pupil and iris, how strong are the genules, and how hard is the nucleus. So all these things make difference in your parameter setting. Then also parameter setting will depend upon your type of the Phaco machine, experience you have, and the techniques you are going to use. So all these things do make a difference in your parameter setting. So you need to set up parameters according to the situation. In nucleus anatomy, we need to understand that as the nucleus keep on becoming harder and harder, it keeps on becoming concave backwards. So if you make a horizontal trench state, the hardest part of the nucleus will not be able to break. So you have got to make a trench according to the shape of the nucleus. And all other aspiration, chopping, everything you should try to perform in a central safe zone. That means you bury the nucleus, lollipop the nucleus, chop it, bring it to the center, because this is here maximum space is available for aspiration. Then aspirate there. So no procedure should be done on a peripheral unsafe zone. That means closer to the iris or closer to the posterior capsule. So this remains the basic for irrespective of the type of the nucleus you are going to handle. Now we know that these are the things which are there in the machine, and these are the tips which are available. Now mostly we use 30 degree tip, and settings will depend upon the type of the machine. Very important thing is the holding power of the nucleus depends upon the bore size of the tip. That means the force is power into the area. So when you use a smaller bore tip and a larger bore tip, actually holding power may increase by 3 times. So whenever you are into a tough case scenario, heart cataract, you need to have bigger bore. So that remains the basic. And flow rate decides how fast the things are going to happen. How strongly you will hold will depend upon a vacuum. So thank you very much. I now invite Dr. Rushad. Rajesh Agya. So Dr. Rajesh Sinha, you all know that he is the treasurer of AIOC Society and very active. So he will be talking about the nucleus management in cases of the small pupil.
At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Harbansh Lal for inviting me in this session. Thank you, sir, for having me here in this wonderful session. And I'll be talking about phacoemulsification and nucleus management in small pupil. Now, the question always arises that what is small for one may not be small for the other. And that is something which people always say, that I can do surgery in this pupil without using anything and I can manage it. So how will we say that this is a small pupil? Now, we all want this kind of a large pupil, right? Well dilated, so that you can do the surgery easily. But any pupil which is of inadequate size, that surgeon believes he might struggle when performing the procedure, is a small pupil for that surgeon. That is true. But that is very subjective. So the point is that you can do a procedure by simple method. Like this is a pupil on the smaller side, 5 millimeter pupil. You can manage a rexis by going under the iris and have a reasonable size. You can do a hydro procedure. While doing nucleus emulsification, you can keep the phaco probe right in the center, use the second instrument with the good fluidics of good machines these days. You can get all the pieces into the center. You can emulsify the nucleus completely. Cortical aspiration also, just keep the tip right up. You see it, go underneath the capsule, remove the cortex, you can complete the procedure. However, the point is this, that you can face some problems in small pupil, and that can be faced at any time, and even in a large pupil. But then in that case, it becomes difficult to salvage. So whatever, the basic idea is this, that the pupil should be such that wherever you are taking the instrument, you should be able to see the tip of the instrument. Because whatever you do, you should be seeing you are doing with that tip of the instrument. That is the key. And that is why, you know, if you do surgeries in small pupil, you can have all sorts of problems. And that is why pupil enlargement is required. So many of these cases, you must be noticing that if you just inject intracameral mediatics, intracameral adrenaline, it will dilate. And it helps. Like this is a case wherein, you know, the pupil is of this size. It doesn't matter, you inject some intracameral adrenaline, the pupil will enlarge, and then with the current generation viscoelastics, you can have a very nice large pupil and you can go ahead and complete the procedure. That is true. But sometimes it doesn't happen. And in that case, you require some gadgets. Sometimes these pupils are non-dilating. So to tell you frankly, we should be telling that how to manage nucleus in a non-dilating pupil, because small can get enlarged by pharmacologic agents. So the most important thing that people use, most important gadget that people use is iris retractor. Now, and most importantly, most commonly, people use 4 iris retractors like this. And then this is the main incision and through which they take their probe inside. This is what I have noted many times. So that is why I'm telling. I personally feel that we should put 2 sub-incisionally. So I will just show in this video how we should put the iris retractors. I personally put 5 retractors. Instead of a quadrangle, I make a pentagon. So I'll just hold it here. See, any instrument that I'm taking inside, it is not touching the iris tissue. Otherwise, if you put 4, the iris will get tent here. And then you will rub the iris and there will be iris chafing, pigment dispersion and all sorts of problems. So I suggest using 2 iris hooks just adjacent and behind the, you can use 1 hook also behind the main incision, or if you make a pentagon, that makes it very easy to manipulate. And this is the main incision, and these are the 2 hooks that are just adjacent so that they are pulling the iris so much that it is not getting touched by any instrument that you are taking inside. And you can see the case has been done nicely. Another option is use of a greater pupil dilator. Now this pupil dilator, I personally feel is a wonderful dilator, the best dilator I would say, because it's a silicone tire which is very soft. You use it, you can have a reasonable size of 6 to 7 millimeter pupil. And then you remove it. Only thing is, it is not reusable. And that is why, also, that is also one reason why it did not become popular. But I felt that, you know, once you have got this much size of pupil, you can go ahead and complete the nucleotomy completely, put the intraocular lens, and then removing is very easy. And once you remove it, there won't be any damage to the pupillary sphincter. That is the key, because this silicone tire is very soft, there's a groove within it. So that is the advantage of pupil, this dilator, but it is not very popular. And the most popular of the dilators is a Milugin ring. So this is the Milugin ring, which is being loaded in the injector, and then it is the distal part of the iris, the opposite to the incision, is first hooked into the loop, And then these two loops are hooked, and you can have a nice pupil, large pupil. The key is that you can perform every procedure under direct visualization. That is most important. And you can remove. And then you can remove it easily. And although the company doesn't advocate reuse of it, but most of us do sterilize and reuse it. We ETO it and we do it. OSS pupil expander is another one which can be used, but this has a very bulky plates here, and that creates problems because it when you are doing a procedure, what happens that it moves, it touches the plate here, it is bulky, and that keeps, if the AC is not very deep, then it keeps moving the iris tissue. So I don't use OSS pupil expander anymore. And the last one which I will be showing is a BHEX pupil expander used by our own Suvin Bhattacharji has made it. And this is a wonderful pupil expander. And it is a soft one, can be introduced through a smaller incision than Milligan ring from the side port as well. And then you can have a nice hexagonal pupil and you can go ahead and complete the procedure. Now, then the key is that, this expander is a little thinner and a little softer. So if you have a IFIS kind of a thing or a pupil which is not dilating, you can use it and you can use it very nicely and with good effect. If the pupil is slightly rigid, maybe some uveitis or some membrane is there, in such a case, this may not be very useful. So Milligan ring is very useful in such a case. So Milligan you can use in any and every case. BHEX is softer, so definitely it can be used in IFIS and other non-dilating pupils. So the message that I would like to give in the end is that you must see what you are doing. That is what, we can do anything. We can do all sorts of adventures depending upon our experience. But in order to minimize damage to ocular tissues and in order to make the procedure reproducible in the hands of everyone, doable in the hands of everyone, if needed, we should use some of these gadgets. And my preferred gadgets are Milligan ring and BHEX ring. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rajesh. Now I'll invite Rushad Sharaf for his next talk, how to manage nucleus in presence of the corneal opacity. And only point I would like to highlight among the talk what Rajesh has given, that whenever you are injecting any ring, do not over pressurize the chamber. Put on a viscoelastic between iris and the anterior lens capsule, because this is where you are going to engage the iris. So if you inflate the chamber and compress the iris along with the capsule, you will find it difficult and you may damage the capsule.
Thank you, sir. I'd like to thank Dr. Harbansh Lal, sir, for inviting me for this instruction course. So I'm going to be talking about nucleus management in the case of corneal opacities. This is just a video that I'm playing, which has sound, so we'll just go through the video.
With advancements in technology, cataract surgery has become fairly straightforward. However, when corneal opacities such as these block our view, operating even the easiest cataract becomes an uphill task. No matter how many times you try to clean and align the microscope, the surgeon feels blind as a bat. Methods to improve visualization include coaxial illumination, light pipe at the limbus, and an endo-illuminator through a limbal incision. We prefer using the 25-gauge chandelier light for visualization along with the constellation system. This clip demonstrates the 25-gauge Rokar cannula with markings at the back that act as a caliper. The chandelier light, which is a self-retaining endo-illumination pipe, fits into the cannula and can be inserted through the pars plana route. The principle behind viewing through a microscope is that when illumination and observation beams are coaxial, a good fundal glow is seen. Corneal opacities interfere with this and scatter light, leading to poor illumination and a poor fundal glow. Endo-illumination with a chandelier light reduces scattering and improves fundal glow along with the surgeon's view. This first case is that of a uniocular patient with very dense corneal opacity following viral keratitis. The chandelier light is introduced as the first step, followed by staining the capsule and then using the pupil expanding device, iris retractors in this case. The microscope light is turned off after the chandelier is turned on. You can see how well the structures are seen. The visibility is markedly improved and creating a rexus appears relatively easy. After that, nucleus disassembly is done using the stop and chop technique, and as noticed, the depth perception is quite good. The cleavage planes are well visualized, which otherwise would have been a nightmare in a case with a dense corneal opacity. We can see the pieces effortlessly being rotated into place and visualized very clearly as they are brought to the safe zone and emulsified. Phaco parameters are reduced during emulsification of the last few pieces, as is seen in this clip. The chamber remains quite stable and there is no fluctuation or surge. Irrigation aspiration is done with the coaxial system. As you can notice, we have managed to neatly take out the entire cortex without any struggle. A foldable IOL is then implanted using a standard injector system. The injector is introduced just beyond the rexus margin and the IOL is inserted into the bag. It is brought into position with the help of the viscoelastic cannula and Lester hook. A good 360 degree cover of the optic is seen and the case is completed. In compromised cornea, such as this case with interface scarring following DALK, it is impossible to perform femtocapsulotomy. This video demonstrates the use of a 25 gauge chandelier light, which was inserted through the pars plana to aid in our visualization. Following this, cyniculysis was performed and iris hook was used to dilate the pupil. The zeptonitinol ring was introduced as demonstrated here. The external light is switched off and the chandelier is switched on, which gives a great fundal glow. The nitinol ring is centered on the light reflex and the suction is built up. Once suction pressure is attained, the machine is set to cut. It cleaves the capsule in about 4 milliseconds. Phaco is performed using the stop and chop technique. A trench is made as demonstrated here and the nucleus is then divided. Pieces can be seen getting emulsified very clearly. The epinucleus is also removed. Irrigation aspiration is performed by the bimanual technique. A foldable IOL is then inserted in the bag and centered. A good optic cover is seen. The sclerotomy site is then sutured with 80 vitreal sutures. At the end, the main wound is also sutured as this is a post DALK case.
When corneal opacities block our view about the structures, the surgeon has no clue. Coaxial illumination and endolights don't seem to do. When we really can't see, it's the chandelier we turn to. Scarring post-viral or scarring in the interface, once the chandelier is on, they fade without a trace. Rexus and chopping can be performed with the usual grace, restoring visibility, depth perception, and a smile to the surgeon's face. To conclude, we would just like to say, with a chandelier to illuminate the way, even a case that took difficult becomes child's play. ensuring the surgeon has a great day.
Thank you.
And now I invite Dr. Anurag Mishra. I've seen some of his video and where he has managed the complicated nucleus. So I thought he'll be the apt person to demonstrate how to handle the nucleus once the PCR takes place. And the only thing, what if you don't have an endo illuminator, because most of the phacoemulsification, the tip is away from the incision. That means if you are doing it temporal, then if the opacity is on the nasal side, it will become very, very difficult. So the your incision should be, or tip should be placed in such an way that if your opacity is nasal, if you do the superior, probably you get a cleaner area to operate upon. So that is very important to where to place the incision in cases of corneal opacity. And Jepto is a very good for ensuring that you get a round rexus. So once you got a round rexus, then if you manage somewhere in the clean area, somewhere if there is some transparent areas there, probably you can go ahead and do the phacoemulsification even without endo illuminator. Dr. Anurag Mishra.
Right, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Greetings and regards from the land of Lord Jagannath. I'm not going to speak anything new to this, because this is something that we have actually learned. This is a stepping stone of learning cataract surgery, the event of posterior capsular rupture and the further nucleus management, or whatever is left in the bag or in the eye, the removal of the same to ensure that there is everything clean before you implant an intraocular lens. So what I'm going to do is to just to concisely refurbished presentation of what we have already learned. So I'm going to share with all of you 3 twos in the next 6. That's the correct way to put it. The first of those twos is 2 mantras. One of them is the memory, the remembrance that the nucleus is not something that is going to be absorbed on its own. So if you have the fragment dropping in, you have to take the assistance of a colleague, and most of us, like me, are standalone private practitioners, so we do not have an associate who deals with the retina. So you have to refer them to another center for the same. The other mantra is to put your vocal cords to rest. There is no mistaking that you will panic in the event of a posterior capsular rupture. But however panicked you are, it should not extrapolate onto your tongue and the voice box. So keep yourself muted, and ask your associates who are roaming about in the OT also to put themselves in the mute format. 2 essential inclusions in the inventory. Once the PCR happens, you have to protect 2 important structures. One of them is already ruptured, which is the posterior capsule, and the other is the delicate endothelial cell layer on the undersurface of the cornea. So the 2 important inventories you should have is a dispersive OVD, and I would advise the inclusion of chondroitin actually as the dispersive of choice, because we know that this is the most negatively charged molecule available to us in the market. So it spreads more widely and protects the endothelium essentially like a sheet. It also protects the capsule, provides a capsular bandage sort of a thing, and protects the capsule and gives us the space to operate upon. We'll see that in the form of certain videos later on. And the other is, of course, the multi-piece IOLs, PAR corrected both for sulcus and bag. Whichever you need can come into play. The 3rd 2 that I would be sharing with all of you is the 2 points to ponder. 1, essentially we have to recognize the PCR happening early, at the earliest stage possible, and to prevent its extension, of course. And then to continue with the nucleus fragmentation as we were doing up till that point in time. So these are the 2 points that we are going to expand on. How do we recognize it early? One of these things is to see the hole happening. So there's one learning point here. Look at this hole happening in the periphery. So this, the first learning comes right here. Never ever to take the phaco needle too peripheral. It does go peripheral when the cataract is soft, but we have to find out a way in which we remain at the center. So just go down on your PAR, learn to control your foot switch, chop more with vacuum, less with PAR. That's the trick to do it. And if you're not comfortable doing that, go ahead to the old school, go back to the old school and trench and then divide. So you see the hole and recognize it early. This is a very hard cataract, as you can see, and this patient is high myopic. Look how it goes. The first segment that was to be chopped was this, and then we subsequently keep on chopping. Look at the first segment that we had chopped. It goes underneath the iris and almost is in the process of getting lost. The whole bag was filled with nucleus. Now suddenly you find a lot of space here. This gives you a signal that something's wrong. So you have to go back and revise what's wrong in there. So that's the second point, how you would recognize an early happening of a PCR. The third is, of course, apart from seeing a rupture happening in the posterior capsule, if you notice, there's a posterior polar cataract, as you can see, and we can already see a rupture happening vertically out here. But what I'm going to show you is a small nuclear fragment, and a small nuclear fragment, and look at the way it fibrillates there. So a larger nuclear fragment will also fibrillate. Look at this nuclear fragment here as it fibrillates. So what happens here is the endophthalmodonosis that happens, which essentially does not transmit to the nuclear fragments just because there is a physical barrier in the form of posterior capsule. Once it ruptures, the endophthalmodonosis does transfer to the nucleus fragments and they start fibrillating. So that's when you know that something's wrong in the posterior capsule. So this is how you recognize it early. This is an age-old teaching. You mustn't do this. This was one of my old amateurish video where the rent happens and they're inside. The rent happens and suddenly panicking, withdraw the phaco probe and it expands the rent essentially. So this is something you should never ever do. Substitute that with viscoelastic before removing it. That prevents the extension. This is something you can do. You after you see the hole, just change your business area. This is where the hole has happened. So you change your business area to diagonally opposite or radially opposite sector and then carry on with emulsification, aspiration of the lens of rest of the nuclear material. Of course, you have to protect the posterior capsule by providing a bandage with the help of dispersive viscoelastic, but this still becomes a little easier because the rent happened in the peripheral portion and the central portion is still free and you can still utilize that as your business area. The other thing that you can do is when you have the last fragment in, you can lift it up after putting in some viscoelastic out of the bag and then can proceed with the phacoemulsification. So once it's out of the bag, you can protect the endothelium with dispersive visco, you can protect the posterior capsule with dispersive visco, and then can still carry on with your job that has been unfinished largely. Still, if you're not comfortable, what you can do is go ahead and use what is known as the IOL scaffold. It has saved many surgeons and many faces time and again, and you can put in the IOL in first, and then can emulsify this hard piece of nucleus, all the while protecting the endothelium as many times as required. Just keep on replenishing it with dispersive viscoelastic. Now, all that teaching does not come into play when you have a situation like the following one. Herein was a patient who had a posterior polar cataract, and look at the anterior segment OCT picture. The whole posterior capsule has given way. It's like a dragon which has already opened its mouth and you just cannot see the spitfire because the cataract was total white and mature. So what you do in this sort of cases is that you cannot manage this nucleus while it is still inside the bag. So what I do is, after a minimal hydro, you have to tar liver the nucleus out. You just cannot manage this nucleus inside the bag. And you cannot do anything to put in the scaffold as well because you can't see the posterior capsule. You don't know where the haptic will go in. So you first of all fragment the nucleus impromptu in the anterior chamber, create a corridor of visibility out here, push these segments into the periphery, and now put in the IOLN. Take the advancing haptic into the sulcus, keep the optic in the pupillary zone, the trailing haptic remains somewhere in the iris, protect the endothelium, go ahead and chop and finish off the business with the nucleus and then the epinuclear plate and then roll the trailing haptic into the sulcus to finish off the procedure. So that's all I have to say. Thank you so much for the attention.
Thank you, Dr. Anurag. How you manage the epinuclear plate after putting the IOL in?
So what I do is, if the posterior capsule is already open, I do not go in with the vitrector because once you remove some amount of vitreous from the area and create a gutter there, it tends to drop down even to the center of the vitreous cortex. So what I do is I use the IOL optic as a nudging device, keep retracting it towards me and then leave it. Keep retracting it towards me and then leave it. So the IOL optic nudges against the epinucleus and lifts it up to the surface of the optic, and then it can be consumed easily. So I don't disturb the vitreous face much and eat away the superficial vitreous cortex while the epinucleus is still lying there.
So excellent technique. I have never used it. But normally what I do, I mean, I'll go and try out this, because I feel I have dropped more epinucleus into the vitreous cavity than nucleus, because nucleus is something you can hold, but epinucleus you can't hold. Cortical fibers you can hold, but the epinucleus is the one which does not come, you are not able to grip and pull it out. And I feel that once you put the infusion from the top, then there is a pressure from the top and then epinucleus goes down.
Absolutely. And if you try to aspirate it, it comes out.
From the pars plana.
Yeah.
And then if you do, then it will have a tendency, because the fluid will be coming from the back to the towards the front side. So the chances of dropping epinucleus will be much less. And if you put the, instead of putting the infusion from
the top. I have tried the posterior levitation of epinucleus in some of these cases, but since you already have a barrier in the form of the IOL optic, it just doesn't lift up. So
good idea. I will try it out.
Thank you, sir.
So I'll be giving next talk now. So put it on. So I think most of us are now doing Phaco in almost all situations. So how to operate heart cataract? And believe me, if you make up your mind that you are going to operate a heart cataract and you don't want to have any corneal edema, you will not have the corneal edema next day. So I'll give you very simple techniques how to manage it. So first is that your rexis should be little on the larger side. That means normally rexis is between 4.5 to 5. You should have between 5 to 5.5. I do not recommend rexis of 6 millimeter or more. And rexis should be more on the nasal side and on the left hand side where you are going to perform most of the phacoemulsification. And then you should make a good V trench, because if you see the configuration of the tip and sleeve, it is in a V shape. So when you make a absolutely horizontal small tip, because you've got to go to the very depth of the nucleus, so if the trench is not wide enough, you won't be able to go to the depth of the nucleus, because it's very much concave backwards. So it has to be V. So once we rotate it, you will find that this V can accommodate your sleeve very well. And in this case, I have not done a hydro dissection at all. No hydro dissection, no hydro delineation. Once you do hydro, the nucleus becomes loose and keeps on rotating. Here you are using a lot of energy. So now, after making the first trench, 80% of trenching has been done. I put on a viscoelastic before drying the probe. Now I am doing the hydro because I have got to rotate the nucleus. So before that, if you do not do hydro, trenching will be very, very easy. And you can really make deep and wide trench. And once we rotate it, now once this V comes to the sub-incisional area, then you actually, now it takes a configuration of the tip and a sleeve. So that means once you want to go deep, this wider V towards the sub-incisional area will allow the sleeve to go in and you can make a deeper trench. So now you can either make a V on the other side and make it like X, or you can make it like Y, go straight and deep in. And most of the time, we are able to split the nucleus. Actually, and the lathy plate is there. Some of the nucleus have got, nucleus, central nucleus is not as hard. It breaks up. But the lathy plate remains there, which is very, very difficult to break, as in this case. So if you try to pull it like this, you are pushing it. You are trying to break so many fibers in one go. So I'll describe over here a technique where the splitting is very, very easy. So I take my Phaco tip with the maximum vacuum setting available on a machine 600, 650. And don't use a micro tip, use a regular tip. And now one edge of that heminucleus where we have got a crack, I go and bury my tip with the maximum hold available on the machine. And with a long chopper, now I will split it. Because now you are splitting one fiber at a time. So this split keeps on going. So it has to be radial split and it goes into center. Look how nicely it goes over there instead of pulling it like this. So just split it. Now you rotate it and do the same thing on the other side. Once you get two half of the heminucleus, then rest of the procedure is very easy comparatively, because each half now you can divide into 5 parts, 6 parts, 4 parts, 3 parts, and make them as smaller as possible. Try to do the phacoemulsification as away from the cornea as possible. Now you can see you have got a nice split over there. Now I'll show you another what happens many a times. We are not able to get a nice split in the center, and the nucleus gets divided into exonucleus and endonucleus. Like the superficial parts get a split and the deeper part, central part, is not splitting. I had another video, but because of the paucity of the time, I will not show you what I call as a flower petal technique. So keep on chopping the exonucleus, keep on leaving the endonucleus. So now it is a superficial crack which is going to take place because the trench was not deep enough at the first place, or sometimes it does not happen even if you feel the trench is good enough. So once we split it, so now you see that I thought the trench is good enough, and once we split it, there is a nucleus which is central part of the nucleus is there attached, but and the nucleus is there, but the trench is division is not complete. So when I go and do, I'm trying to make into two parts, but some or the other I fail over here. So what I'm going to do is, now watch, my tip is too superficial. It is not holding on to the deeper part of the nucleus. And when I divide it, the central part is not, but the outer part of the nucleus is going behind and is splitting like this, like epinuclear plate. So what I'll do now, I'll keep on doing the same. All places I leave the central part untouched, and keep on chopping the superficial or outer rim of this nucleus. Now this is also getting a split into, as the split is going even behind the central nucleus. So actually you can plan it this way for whole of the nucleus also, because I'm just showing half. If sometimes you get trapped, what you should do when you don't get a central crack complete. So I keep on doing it, and once this is done, the central part is becoming looser from anterior and posterior side both. And then before doing it, you can see that now I can lift up the central nucleus very easily. This is half, you can do it same for the full nucleus. And once this is lifted up, now rest of the part with the exonucleus is very easy to lift it up. So first we lift it up and then we remove the exonucleus part. So now rest of the surgery becomes very easy. You can see that this can be lifted up. So this is many times we have a problem. So now to conclude, settings should be very high and tip should be large initially. As long as the nucleus is in the capsular bag, you are not going to have a PCR. PCR will take place when part of the nucleus is out and the capsule is mobile. So initially for chopping, when you are doing aspiration, then you can keep on lowering the setting. So start with 600, 500, 400, you can keep on lowering and keep on injecting the viscoelastic. CCC should be large. Do not hydrate initially, otherwise nucleus keeps on rotating when you are trenching. Wide and deep trench, because energy used for trenching causes no collateral damage. Use that I already explained. And each hemi-nucleus should be divided into four or five pieces. Initially long chopper, and once you come to the last fragment, when you are chopped, then take a smaller chopper, remove the sharp and long chopper and inject the viscoelastic. Thank you. And now I invite Dr. Rike Dalal. Hello, Rajiv, you want to go? Dr. Rajiv Chaudhary, and he'll be talking about PHACO in subluxated. Please focus only on nucleus removal. Okay.
Good afternoon. Thanks to Harbansh for inviting me for this session. My topic is on the subluxated cataract. we come across so many type of this type of the cases. There are multiple degree of subluxation, 1 to 3, 3 to 9, or more than that. So we can have the different technology available or different options we can choose according to. And these are the real challenge for ophthalmic surgeon. There are the multiple causes. We know, I am not going to for the theoretical discussion on this. So it depends, depending on the preoperative evaluation, what is the degree of and what is the grade of the nucleus. So in short, we can have this summarized that subluxation, you can go with the only phaco and oil, your haptics placed in the direction of subluxation. With the subluxation 3 to 5 o'clock hours, you have a slow phaco with CTR, CONE ring. If it is more than, you need segment suturing of that CONE ring. And if it is more than 7, like you do pars plana lensectomy, then scleral fixated or glue diol or iris cloyol. So this is a short video on the, it's less than 3 o'clock. Rexis should be from the away of the side of the zonular dehiscence. Strength possibility, so you can identify the capsular margin. Taking care that you should inject, it is the slightly hard cataract, so you feel that the subluxation is more, but it is around 3. Viscot is one of the best use, so that cover that subluxation portion so that your fragment will not fall out. Slow phaco, sometimes you need a higher phaco power to emulsify because you don't want to waste the time here. Keeping the slow phaco, bottle height should be minimum. There should not be fluctuation in the chamber because that will increase your subluxation. So use of repeated use of the viscoelastic is one of the important, and chopping. Slightly big into the pupillary plane so that you should avoid the any stress on the capsule because the zonules are weak. Any more stress can increase your subluxation. And then you can put the lens. In this case, that lens should be placed at the direction of subhaptic, so that will work as a CONE ring. When it is more than, you can see that again the parameters should be slow. Rexis started from the area of away from the area of zonular dehiscence. Use good viscoelastic, and I prefer to use Viscot in this area so that if there is a vitreous, you can do the vitrectomy also. This cataract is soft. And then put the CONE ring. Once you have separated the nucleus from the capsule, you can very well put the CONE ring before. You can eat with the forceps, or there is an injector available. Once CONE ring is in place, your phaco will become slightly easier. Keeping, because it's removing this cortical, sometimes it is engaged with the CONE ring, so there should be slow aspiration of this cortical fiber because they are sometimes engaged with the CONE ring, and again it will pull the with CONE ring the capsule and everything. If it is more than 7 o'clock hours, hypermature cataract, Rexis started from the area. Slowly, chamber should be maintained. Each and slightly eccentric Rexis. I am not going on this direction so that to avoid more, because this is comparatively safe zone. And because the lens is gentle hydro. Slow. Now you see that it is giving more turbulence, and probably we may end up with the more problem. Increase the phaco power with the low vacuum so that I can emulsify the nucleus well. Then I decided to put the
capsular hook so that either you, many times you can use iris roco also, but they are slightly sharp, so use. So putting the capsular hook will give the stability to the capsular beak. Two hook will be sufficient. Once the your beak is stable, now you can do the phacoemulsification very well. And use the repeated, use the viscoelastic, the capsule is, bag is very well stable because of the hooks. But once you remove this, you need to suture that sioneering here, because once you remove the hook, that again bag is unstable. So after removing the, because it was not possible to use sioneering or suture it before because the nucleus fragment was not, or nucleus not out. So once it is there, you can suture the sioneering, just this, making a scleral pocket here at the 6 o'clock, and you can very well put the, once the sioneering is sutured, remove this hook and you can put the lens in the back. So another option, when there is a multiple, you can do more than this. It's not possible to use here. You can use remove this with the cutter, because it was the congenital soft cataract. It's simple to remove with the, I'm not, once you remove, the an option to put the lens is the, either you can use silk, scleral fixated glue dial or iris cloth. I put the iris cloth. You see that how posterior inclination, how simple it is. Instead of all your trouble for the scleral glue in the time of crisis, just put and this. This lens is in the place. Now roll up the femto. This is the eccentric lexis you can do on the subluxated cataract. That is possible with the, because in subluxated it is difficult to do the lexis, because once you do the lexis, there will, you are going to give the more stress on the genules and you may end up. So if you want to put, not use scleral fixated or glued, you want to put the lens in the bag or sulcus, you can do the rexis with the, because this will give without stress the rexis on the center. You can shift that rexis. Once you remove this cortical cleanup is simple. You can suture the segment here, making the scleral pocket. You just make suture. And once you made that, it is all sutured. Cortical cleanup, and you can put the three-piece lens either in the bag or sulcus without having the need for glue dial or scleral fixated. So in short, recent advancement, or it is not a recent, there is so many of us are doing the same, better understanding of fluidics, relative safe cataract surgery even in subluxated cataract. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. So I think we do have a little time. Are there any questions from the audience that anyone wants to ask regarding any of the talks so far?
You can use the microphone over there. The stand microphone?
Yes.
Hello, sir. My question is about the AC maintenance in subluxated lenses.
Instead of AC, because it will give the more pressure. Yeah. We want the flat. We don't want very deep because the genules are weak. Yeah. So if you use viscoelastic, either you use repeated viscoelastic, and best thing is to use the viscot, because it will protect your nuclear fragment going down, and it will keep the chamber stable. So that will be more stable. AC maintenance will give the deep chamber.
Is your question about AC maintainers for SFIOLs or just in...
You can go for SFIOL, AC maintenance, okay, once it is the for the nucleus removal, for SFIOL it's okay.
So for AC maintainer, they are using trocars with the AC maintainer so that it doesn't slip out. That keeps it a little more tightly in the anterior chamber. That's a good way of doing it. Although generally, I mean, most people prefer if you have VR backup that someone puts it posteriorly, an infusion cannula, and that helps a little bit more in an SFIOL. So you were saying something.
No, I was saying that if the vitreous stands naked, you just don't hydrate it. So for the nucleus management thing, an AC maintainer, anything that hydrates the vitreous is an absolute no-no. And so it is rightly pointed out that the sealing effect has to be there with the dispersive viscoelastic so that you have a barrier. Because you don't have a barrier at one segment, you create a barrier there so that nothing goes into the posterior surface and nothing, there's no vitreous knuckle that tries to protrude, because you are artificially increasing the intraocular pressure, right? So there could be a vitreous knuckle just protruding up. So for both of those preventions, you need a mechanical barrier. I would just like to add to a few things that Sir has very nicely summarized. Once we are trying to implant a CTR into a subluxated bag, the eyelet of the CTR should try to be put opposite the area where the subluxation has happened. If subluxation has happened here, the first eyelet, the leading eyelet, should go here. The reason for that is when the eyelets meet, that is the area of least radial pressure onto the bag. We want maximum radial pressure in the dialyzed segment. Okay, so that is... that can happen only if you start putting the or rotating the CTR from the opposite quadrant. That's number one. Number two, when we are trying to take a bite through the eye for suturing a CTS, before that the capsular hook should be removed because they lift the capsular bag up. And with them in place, if you're trying to take the bite through the sclera, there's every possibility that they may go right through the bag and you cannot have the eyelet suturing possible properly. The third thing is the side port's direction and geometry is a little different when you're trying to put in a CTR, a capsular hook, and an iris hook. So when you're putting the iris hook, the side port should be a little more peripheral, and they should be running parallel to the iris surface so that you don't have a tenting of the iris segment. When you're putting in the capsular hook, you can go a little anterior and make it more vertical, because essentially what you're trying to do, you're mechanically trying to lift the capsular bag up. So you're giving a vertical support to the whole capsular bag. So they should be a little more anterior and pass a little more vertically. But in case of the iris hooks, they should be absolutely as parallel as they can and running parallel to the iris surface.
That's because both have the different direction. Because they do.
True. Yeah. Over Thank to you, Lal.
A very good afternoon to all of you. I'm very happy to be here and talking to you about two very important aspects of nucleus management. The first would be the soft cataract. Can we have the slides, please? So the first challenge that we face is that these patients are usually younger and they have an elastic capsule. So forceps might come in handy as compared to a cystotome in these patients. The second problem is during the phacoemulsification. In harder cataracts, we tend to use higher vacuums, and they give us a good hold also because of the density of the cataract, it's easier to hold them well. Whereas the softer cataracts, we tend to use lower vacuums, which leads to a poorer hold, and also because of the density of the nucleus, it's more difficult to hold on to them, and this leads to difficulty in chopping. These patients also have a sticky epinucleus, which makes it very difficult for us to pull the nucleus towards the center and operate in the central safe zone. Therefore, there's a tendency towards operating in the peripheral zone, which leads to a posterior capsular rupture. So let's look at a few surgical videos here. This is actually a case of a high myopic patient who's planned for refractive lens exchange as he's unsuitable for ICL. So we can see that the capsule is a little elastic, although I managed to complete the Rexus with the cystatome itself. Hydro procedures are extremely useful and are best friends here. We need to do a good hydro dissection and delineation. And what I'm trying to do here is just lift up one of the poles. So I've just lifted up the pole just with the hydro. And this makes it very easy for us to emulsify these soft cataracts because we just need more of a vacuum and we hardly need any phaco power. Now I'm finding it a little difficult here to lift up this last fragment. So what I'm doing here is again gently just lifting it up. You can either use viscoelastic or a little bit of hydro, we can do again, and then lift it up and bring it to the central safe zone, and now it can be emulsified with ease. Now since this is a high myope, before I come out of the eye, I'm injecting viscoelastic to avoid chamber fluctuations, followed by an irrigation aspiration and a lens. Now, sometimes, the hydro prolapse is not possible, or the nucleus density might not be as soft as I showed in the first case. And these cases, what we can do is, because the epinucleus is so sticky, it makes it very difficult for us to actually lift up this nucleus up. So first thing is that, of course, we need to do a good hydro delineation, which would free up the central nucleus. And what we are doing here is we are just rotating this lens, going all around and removing this sticky anterior epinuclear plate. This technique in my hands works really well. If I remove the anterior epinucleus and the cortex well, then what we can do here is just lift up this entire nucleus with the help of our chopper, because there's nothing holding on to it now. And this can be emulsified with ease now. And again, because we are not using much of a phaco energy here, even if we are a little anterior in these soft cataracts, we are not very bothered about the cornea. And this is another case, and I'll show you the technique of stop and chop in these softer cataracts here. So here, this patient is planned for stop and chop. Again, I'm following the same principles of first removing the anterior epinucleus here, rotating it and going over so that I can free up this nucleus and makes it easier for me to further chop. Now, the trench here doesn't need to be too deep or too wide. If we make it too wide, again, it will make it very difficult to hold on to that soft lens. So we just make a relatively shallower trench, or narrower trench, as we would make in harder cataracts. And now again, freeing up this nucleus from the epinuclear plate becomes easy, and we can go ahead with all our chopping maneuvers. So stop and chop also comes in handy for few of these patients where the nucleus is not soft enough, or you don't want to do a hydro prolapse, or the rexus is not big enough for us to prolapse one of the poles out of the bag. So I'm going ahead with the chopping, and then we'll clean it up and implant an IOL in place. Now, my last case here highlights some of the difficulties that we face in these softer cataracts. So again, the plan here is stop and chop. I'm going ahead with my trench and then dividing this into two. Now, what happens here is that because the nucleus is soft, we are just splicing through this cataract, and there's a tendency towards formation of a bowl where we try to hold on to the lens and just gives away. So this is what the difficulty I'm facing here. So when this happens, decrease the amount of energy to as low as possible, maybe 2% or 5%. Increase the vacuum. So I'm using about, now I've increased my vacuum and made it about 450 millimeters of mercury. And then hold on slightly more anteriorly and grab one of the poles and grab the lens fragment here, so that gently and slowly, if we keep applying vacuum with very low power, if we can just get one of the heminuclear up, then we can, rest of the surgery becomes very easy and we are able to go ahead with this. So this case highlights what to do when we have a formation of a bowl and how to come out of it. And this is the end of the case. This is my last case that I would like to show for this talk, and we'll go on to the posterior polar cataract. Now, posterior polar cataracts also tend to be a little softer, and there are certain things that we need to keep in mind when we are dealing with posterior polar cataracts. So here, this is a patient who has nucleus sclerosis with high hypermetropia and pterygium. The two important things in biometry that we need to look at is the aqueous depth, which is adequate, and the amount of astigmatism. This is why this patient is planned only for a cataract surgery and not a pterygium surgery planned subsequently followed by a cataract surgery here. So the patient is not bothered about the pterygium. He just wants visual rehabilitation. That's why we are not combining it with the pterygium surgery. Also, that could be an alternative here. So the rexus in these patients, when we are talking about posterior polar cataracts, needs to be of adequate size, 5 to 5.5 millimeter, not too large, just in case we have a PC rent and we need to do an optic capture. We have to avoid hydro dissection, as we all know here. So what I alternatively do is that I use viscoelastic, very small amounts, and I just go underneath this anterior capsule and inject very small amounts of viscoelastic. What this does is that when I'm doing a hydro delineation, it prevents an inadvertent hydro dissection, so that the fluid wave cannot go in the area of the hydro dissection because we have created amount of resistance here. Now, this is again, these cataracts tend to be relatively soft, and my plan here is to make a trench first and divide this nucleus into two. So this is the trench that we are going ahead with, and then we are going to divide. So while dividing the nucleus, we have to be a little careful not to apply too much pressure. You have to remember that posterior capsule can be very fragile in these patients. And now just lift up one of the heminuclei without much rotation, as less of rotation as possibly we can manage with, unlike the normal cataract where we rotate the nucleus. So just embed and lift and then further chop, so that we are avoiding the stress on the posterior capsule at all points of time. Another important aspect of posterior polar cataracts is that before we come out of the eye, we have to remember to either inject viscoelastic, because we do not want the chamber to collapse at any point of time. That itself can lead to a posterior capsular rent in these patients. Now what I do here is I inject some viscoelastic under the epinucleus. This does two things: helps in prolapsing the epinuclear plate, and also if there is a PCR, then that will plug the PCR and make it easier and safer for us to operate. So this epinuclear plate is being emulsified, and we can see that posterior polar aspect of the cataract has come in with the posterior epinuclear plate. Then we are just using bimanual irrigation aspiration here to clean up this cortex. We should avoid capsular polishing in these patients. Even if there's a little bit of a pacification, it is better to yag it later rather than to risk a posterior capsular rupture. I have enlarged the incision a bit because this is a 36 diopter IOL. This is a highly hypermetropic patient. So I don't want to do a wound assisted implantation of the lens here. And before going in, I'm injecting a viscoelastic. Now, this is the left eye of the same patient. The initial steps are absolutely similar, the technique of visco dissection and then followed by a hydro delineation. But the nucleus management is going to be slightly different for this eye, as this is a slightly softer cataract than his right eye. This is the left eye of the same patient. So as soon as I go ahead and trench it a little bit, I can just lift up this nucleus, and we are just prolapsing the nucleus and then emulsifying it with ease. So this is because these patients again have softer lenses. This could be a useful technique, and this again works very well in these patients. And then rest of the procedures followed are the same. We are going to remove the epinucleus by injecting some viscoelastic and placing the IOL. Now, my next case, I will just highlight a patient where we had a posterior capsular rupture during cataract surgery, probably pre-existing dehiscence of the PC. So I'm making the trench here and following the same technique. I have divided the nucleus. We can see it's a relatively soft cataract. I'm trying not to rotate the nucleus as much as possible, and then just emulsifying the fragments. So this goes on relatively uneventfully, and we are able to do this very well. And then I'm going to inject some viscoelastic before I come out, and also to behind the epinucleus plate. So this is the viscoelastic going in, and again following the technique of visco dissection and injecting a little bit. We do not need to inject too much of a viscoelastic because that could again stress the posterior capsule just a little bit so that it can seal the rent and also bring the epinucleus up. So till this time I'm unaware that there is any issue, and now I visualize it here that there is a posterior capsular rupture right in this area. So I am injecting viscoelastic to just plug the defect. Important to inject viscoelastic before coming out of the eye. I am just using dispersive viscoelastic here and then going ahead with the vitrectomy. So we are doing a limited anterior vitrectomy, making sure that there is no vitreous in the anterior chamber, and injecting viscoelastic again before I come out. Then I shift over to my irrigation aspiration, bimanual irrigation aspiration, once I have taken care of the vitreous. And I'm starting to aspirate the cortex away from the area where I've had the PCR. So I'm injecting, I'm removing all the cortex, away from the area of the dehiscence. And being very, very careful here, we might need to switch between the vitrectomy cutter or use the vitrectomy cutter itself to remove a little bit of the cortex. So if we feel that at any point of time the irrigation aspiration handpiece is not coming in handy and it's a little unsafe, we can just use the vitrectomy cutter, aspirate the residual amount of cortex and the vitreous cutting mode if needed. And then we are implanting a three-piece IOL in the sulcus here. The plan has to be changed. We need to have a backup of a three-piece IOL when we are planning our posterior polar cataracts, because these lenses are safe to use in the sulcus. And again, checking for the vitreous. We can stain if needed, with triamcinolone alone to see if there's any residual vitreous towards the end of the procedure. We can also use pilocarpine to see that there is no vitreous tag remaining and the pupil constricts well. And this is the end of the surgery. Thank you so much for your attention. Thank you.
Any questions from the audience? Because we are waiting for one speaker. So if there are any questions, we can start the discussion. But any audience, if anything wants to be cleared about the nucleotomy, please ask the question if you have got anything. Anything bothering you? Any type of the nucleotomy technique you feel is superior, or anything you want to know. So if there are no questions, I'll tell you one thing very important. Once I was doing a live surgery and I demonstrated a stop and chop technique. So the one doctor comes and tells me, "Doc sir, you have relieved my tension." I used to think if I'm not doing a direct chop, probably I'm an inferior surgeon. So it is not important what technique you are doing. It is important what you are offering to the patient, whether your cornea next day is clear or not. Whether you are doing a stop and chop, whether you are doing a direct chop, whether you are doing divide and conquer, it makes no difference. So 1 or 2 minutes extra is not important. It is important to be safe and the cornea should be clear. So do not feel that you must convert to the direct chop. If you are, I have never converted. I mean, I started as a direct chop surgeon because at that time, Dr. Ashok Sharaf, please, Dr. Sharaf, straight away. We are waiting for you only. Your talk is lost. So Dr. Ashok Sharaf is already here. He has actually left his own session and has come over here. So he'll be talking about the nucleus removal in intumescent cataract. So feel I started as a direct chop because at that time stop and chop was not invented. So there was a divide and conquer, direct chop. And then it was invented that you start as a divide and conquer, stop halfway through and then chop. That is how it derived its name, stop and chop. So it started as a divide and conquer. So this gives the best control. So if you are doing it, please continue. Don't worry about. But direct chop, of course, whenever the nucleus is not stable and an intumescent cataract, nucleus is rotating around, loose nucleus, probably you definitely have to resort to the direct chop.
So in hard cataracts, what I found was what you demonstrated very nicely to make the trench. There's no need to do heroics in that.
Yeah.
So, but what you mentioned was very true, that it's easier when you actually bury the phaco probe and use the vacuum to separate it. Normally, I make two trenches and do the same thing to separate that way.
Good evening, friends. Thank you, Dr. Harbansh Lal, for inviting me and including me in your beautiful course. I will be sharing my some videos regarding the management of intumescence cataract. The intumescence white cataract is a morphological diagnosis where the cortex swells up. So that's why the AC becomes shallow and intralenticular pressure, it goes high. That's very important. The most important to take the precautions because of this high intraocular pressure. And there is always a fear of extension of axis. You can see that, and their axis has extended. So the debulking is must. And how to do debulk? There are options. Either you do the capsulotomy 30 minutes before, YAG capsulotomy, and allow, make a little small opening, allow the cortex, fluid cortex to come into the anterior chamber, and then take the patient. Or else, on table you can puncture the anterior capsule, allow the milky fluid to escape, and there is a Mohan-Rajan technique, very good technique. Then we have modified our technique also, and there is an orange field method too. You can see here, very old video. We didn't have much knowledge about the management, but however, we would know at that time that the pressure has to reduce so that to avoid the extension. This is the Mohan-Rajan where he is using venturi system, 500 vacuum, straight tip, and he would do that. See, the fluid has come into the probe, and there is a little small pit into the anterior cortex too. This is our technique. What we do here, that I'm holding the main surgeon is holding the needle, sharp 26 gauge needle, attached to two cc syringe, and that syringe is held by the assistant. And then after staining, make a puncture, and then the fluid is allowed to be sucked into the syringe. You can see here the intralenticular pressure is already reduced, and now put the visco from the chamber and do the raxis. Now you can do the controlled raxis. However, because of if the capsule is thin, you must take precaution that it should not extend to the periphery. This is the last scene. The Phaco procedure here, once you do the raxis, there is a very little peripheral cortex, no epinucleus. So there is no need for hydro. And the routine Phaco, what you do, but however, you have to have the lower parameters. And because there is no epinucleus, you have to be very careful to avoid the PCR. You can see here, there is a white intumescence cataract. I'm trying to aspirate the fluid. The raxis has little become irregular, but I could remove the fluid, and so the intraocular lenticular pressure was reduced after putting good visco, forming the chamber, and then you can do the controlled raxis. You can see them. These are male, 48 years. So I'm expecting a very, and the cataract is intumescence really, no hard nucleus. And even without hydro, you can rotate the nucleus. And making the trench as usual, I do this is my choice of doing the direct cracking. If the nucleus part comes a little anterior to the iris, don't worry about it. It may have, you have to go and inject in the visco. But if your probe goes near to the posterior capsule, then you can end up in problem. See, once it is done, you find very, very hardly little cortex. It can be aspirated. And you can put the lens. Sometimes it is safe to make a very small rexis, very small rexis. This is a, and then after doing the phaco, you can enlarge it. You have to be a little careful while doing the phaco because the opening is small. But once it is done, you can enlarge the rexis. As usual, you have to be very careful. It should not extend to the periphery. Then, one more. This is interesting video I would like to show. Okay. Just 1 minute.
By the time he is finding the video, I'll just make one or two comments. Normally, whenever I am operating these type of cataracts, yeah, you got the video?
Yeah.
Yeah, go ahead.
So you will see it. I'm trying to aspirate the fluid. And inadvertently, you can see the rexis is already enlarged. But then you have to be very careful because I was in the safe limit. It didn't go to the periphery. And once you complete the rexis, as usual, same, do the phaco. There is one point which we should remember, that at times, suppose there is a central posterior polar cataract along with this. Maybe, then in that case you have to be very careful that by chance you should not open the posterior capsule. So this is how it's done. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Shrap, wonderful presentation. One change what I do is I normally, of course, he is also not doing any hydro procedure, but he is trying to rotate the nucleus. I do not rotate because I want the stability of the nucleus for trenching. So I keep it that way. Only after trenching I rotate. Secondly, routinely what I found, the side port incision leaks a lot. Because for irrigation aspiration, we want little bigger port and the chopper is thinner. So now in all cases, routinely, initially I used to do only for a heart cataract when I was using higher setting. In all cases, when I am going to remove my last fragment, because I don't have to chop now anymore, and I remove my chopper from the side port, so leakage is stopped. And if by any chance the posterior capsule is floppy, you will see because of the zonular weakness, sometimes the posterior capsule, you can see the crumbled. Or whenever the nucleus is very large in a mature cataract and a heart cataract, because it stretches the posterior capsule a lot. So in these cases, you may have to inject the viscoelastic to push the posterior capsule back before removing the last fragment. So as long as the nucleus is inside the capsule of fornices, it holds the posterior capsule back. Once the last fragment has come out, the posterior capsule will have more tendency to come forward. And even if the zonules are weak, sometimes because of zonular dehiscence or something, you might even ask your assistant to keep on injecting the viscoelastic if you feel the posterior capsule is too floppy and every time it is coming. So at that time, I will rather a little bit compromise on the cornea, put on a viscoat if possible, if you can afford it, patient can afford it. Then otherwise, even at the last fragment when I am removing, if I feel the posterior capsule is coming towards the port, I'll rather come closer to the cornea, let patient have a little bit of corneal edema which is settled down, than trying to compromise on the posterior capsule. And in a smaller pupil, the whenever you use the capsular hooks, normally we when we make a side port incision for chopping, it is corneal, because it's a corneal because we don't want the conjunctival chemosis. If we make a limbal incision, fluid will keep on coming and will cause conjunctival chemosis. But when you are putting the iris hook, you don't want iris to get lifted up. So your incision could be more limbus and you're not going to do the irrigation from that side, so there will be no conjunctival chemosis. So more the limbal incision, iris will be pressed down. And secondly, more posterior incision. Secondly, our aim is that the internal margin of the pupil should be beyond the incision line. That means your internal lip, this is from where the iris is going to collapse. If the pupil border is behind the internal lip, then iris is not going to collapse. Your phaco tip is not going to rub. So you can make, like Rajesh Sinha was showing you can give a five hooks, or you can make a trapezoid incision. That means the incision closer to the incision, the hooks you can place them closer, and away from it you can place them wider. And so that if they are closer, they will pull the iris and pull the incision behind it. Same thing, if any time iris starts collapsing in the middle of the surgery, whether it's a side port or a main port. If it is a side port, then you can change the side port. Leave that side port, make another very small side port, which is more corneal than limbal, and so that it won't collapse. But if it is on the main incision, then you can put again two hooks just adjacent to the main incision, so that you can pull the pupillary border towards the periphery and it is not collapsing. But you place too far off away, it will still keep on collapsing. Keep on putting in viscoelastic. Do hypovolumic phacoemulsification in these cases. That means not most of the fluid should keep on going, and try to press the capsule against the anterior, iris against the anterior capsule. That means when you are not doing any phacoemulsification, keep the flow little up. Don't keep it at the iris plane. When you're doing nothing, so that it presses the iris against the capsule. Not that you do underneath the iris and it keeps on blowing up. Any other comment you would like to make on any other technique or something you would like to give the message?
Yeah, we actually had a discussion while you were away, sir. But segment of intermittent cataracts, see, you would find intermittence of two types, and usually it is a perinuclear intermittence that happens both on the anterior and the posterior fronts, but it is not unusual to find a pure posterior intermittence. It's rare, but it can happen. So in those cases, what will happen is, after you conclude managing the nucleus, you may find certain milky substance in the anterior vitreous cortex floating. So that has already percolated the posterior capsule and gets deposited there. Most of the time you can leave it alone and it doesn't produce any post-operative inflammation. However, if you have it in your hands and you do trust your skills, then I would recommend that you go through the posterior capsule, clear some amount of superficial vitreous cortex, and along with take out the milky cortex so that it doesn't leave any opportunity for a phacoanaphylaxis to happen in the post-operative period. That's it.
So I will not be so adventurous, and probably you have to have a pressure of finishing off the list also. But only thing, sometimes you may get confused whether there is a PCR or not. So whenever you see the opacity behind, so you may get panicked, have something drop. So if you see the donasis or the movement of this over there will be very slow and moving like this, so you have got to be very careful when you see it. Initially, when I used to get doubtful, what is happening? Whether I have ruptured the posterior capsule. So you've got to be careful and make sure that it is not the rupture, but it is the donasis of the vitreous with along slowly and slowly some opacities or some the fluid is moving around. So diagnose it well. Then if you want to leave it, you can leave it as such. If you want to remove, as he is saying, if you have got the guts to go and rupture the posterior capsule and remove it, otherwise I'll prefer to leave it as such instead of doing PCC and then trying to remove it. Any other comment Roshad or Ikeda would like to make?
Just regarding the small pupil, if you can use viscote to push the iris back also, that tends to help quite a lot because it keeps it posteriorly and it doesn't tend to keep prolapsing out.
I think all the points are very well covered, and I think we are running short of time. We have already been
told to conclude the session. So thank you all for being here.
So thank you all for being here throughout. And we enjoyed this session. I hope we could give you some useful tips. Thank you very much.